Welcome. We're glad you're here. This is a safe place, filled with friendly people, where you are accepted, cared about, and loved. We're not perfect, but we serve a God who is. Today we're going to sing together, because God is worthy of our praise. Today we're going to learn together, because the Bible is relevant to our lives. Today is all about Him, and we wouldn't have it any other way. Thanks for joining us today. We're so glad you did. Welcome home.
Good morning, church. Hey, what did I hear? Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Yeah, what a beautiful day to be alive. We are so glad to be here. C'est bon être ici entre nous sommes les bons peuples de Dieu. It is wonderful to be together in this place. Trinity and Anjou United Churches worshiping together indeed. I am so blessed that we are here, that we have electricity this morning. Anybody not have electricity where you are? Michaela's raising her hand in the back. All around us, maybe you know this, there have been storms and winds, sheets of rain. In Joliet, the high school roof was blown off. I hear just this morning from Robert Thompson that a Trinity United Church in Uxbridge lost its roof, I think, and maybe more of its building. So my goodness, the weather has created quite a storm, and we want to keep those without power in our prayers this morning. And if there are ways that we can assist that as well. We're talking today about how a good God can allow bad things to happen. That's our theme. And certainly the wonders of nature that we love can also unleash great destruction from time to time. And so we challenge ourselves with this thinking this morning. Many of you will have received the notice, and I mentioned it, I think, in church in the last week or so, that Deborah Dolly Udit, I don't see Deborah here this morning, her son Kevin has died. We just got the information about the visiting hours and reception that will be held in Shadowgate tomorrow on Monday the 30th, and it will be at noon, noon to 4. So I know a few of us are going to go to support Deborah in the loss of her son. And we're grateful for a God who promises us the gift of eternal life. Amen. We gather as we are wont on these beautiful lands of Montreal, Geojage, with these words. Friends, we do gather on lands that hold a long and rich history of occupation and stewardship by First Nations peoples for millennia through to the present day. First Nations peoples, such as those from the Haudenosaunee Nation and the Anishinaabeg Nation, have deep, strong historical ties to this land. Montreal, known as Geojage to the Haudenosaunee and as Moniang to the Anishinaabeg, has long served as a site of meeting and exchange for amongst various First Nations groups. We acknowledge and thank the diverse peoples whose presence marks this territory, on which peoples of the world now gather. Would you join with me in our call to worship, joining in on the lines mark all. Hope of the world, you come close in our need when hope seems lost and we don't know way to turn.
Which way to come.
Come near. Merci Seigneur pour ton amour. Merci Seigneur pour ta fidélité. And we pray these words together. God of our hearts, we thank you for sticking by us with love that is unconditional. You send us Jesus to show us the way. You give us Christ that we might be strong. With Christ beside me, Christ before me, Christ behind me, you lift my spirit up. Je chante ta louange. I sing your praise this day and always. Amen. And we offer these, the words of Jesus, in English and in French. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Notre Père qui es aux cieux, que ton nom soit sanctifié, que ton règne vienne, que ta volonté soit faite sur la terre comme au ciel. Donne-nous aujourd'hui notre pain de ce jour. Pardonnons nos offenses, comme nous pardonnons aussi à ceux et celles qui nous ont offensés. Et ne nous laisse pas entrer en tentation, mais délivre-nous du mal. Car c'est à toi qu'appartient le règne, la puissance et la gloire, pour les siècles des siècles. Amen. Our young people who are veterans of Vacation Bible School will know this song very well. We have sung it in church here as well too. If God is for me, who can be against me? And we'll rise as we sing.
Don't understand.
God is for me.
just jump in that water. I want to do that too. Amen. Oh. Wow, we got to get in on some of that kid action. What are you thinking there? Wow. That is superb. And summer is here. Who's excited? Moi. Yeah, excellent. Well, friends, today we're talking about why God allows bad things to happen. Why does God allow bad things to happen? It's a great question, because how could we say that God is all good when we know there are so many bad things going on in the world? Can anybody name something that's not so great happening right now? The war in Ukraine, absolutely. Anything else? Yeah, people without power, roofs blown off of buildings. We have the climate crisis. Maybe that's a part of these more extreme weather events we're having. What about hunger around the world? We hear if Ukraine grain doesn't get to where it needs to go, millions may be in a place of hunger. There are so many refugees around the world and right here in Canada needing a place to call home. As Canada celebrates Asian Heritage Month in May, I was thinking of a friend of mine in Ottawa who went through a very hard time. Her name is Twi Tran. She came to Canada as a refugee from Vietnam a long time ago in the late 1990s. Ooh, that seems like a long time ago for some of us. Who wasn't even born in 1999? Ah, there are several of us. Yay, we love you, younger people. So, Twi left her home country of Vietnam by a small boat to get away from an economic and political situation that gave her no hope for a good life. From 1975, those of us who are around will remember, all the way till 1999, 1.6 million Vietnamese and others fled from that region. They left their homes. Many of them, they had to go in the middle of the night by small boats. Their governments didn't want them to go. So many left on boats that they became collectively known at that time as the boat people. Unlike my friend Twi, many of them didn't survive the trip to neighboring countries where their boats encountered storms and even pirates. And then a lot of the countries around Vietnam, they wanted to shut their borders down so that many people who were desperate to be safe and to be free and to be able to make a life for themselves, they were just left out in the waters. They couldn't land. How could a good God allow something so bad like that to happen? It doesn't make any sense. We're going to listen now to a video that might just help us understand what maybe God is up to.
Why does God let bad things?
Some Christians believe that God is omniscient, which means God knows everything there is to know about anything. God, did you?
Yep.
Are penguins?
Nope.
Do you?
Sometimes.
Some Christians also believe that God is omnipresent, which means God is everywhere all the time.
God, could you be with my friend Steve in Toledo?
I already am.
But you're here.
I know! Crazy, right?
Christians also believe that God is omnipotent, which means God can do anything. Anything God wants to do at any time. God could, if God wanted to, make it rain birthday cakes or turn you into a tube sock.
A tube sock?
And finally, Some Christians believe that God loves us unconditionally, even if you were turned into a tube sock. The question a lot of people, including Christians, have is, if God is everywhere, knows everything, and can do anything, and especially if God loves everyone, then why does God let bad things happen?
Hey!
Are we supposed to know the answer?
Don't look at me. I'm just a tube sock.
This is actually one of the biggest, most perplexing questions of all. For some, the response to this is that God is not all-powerful.
Wait, you just said...
What is meant by this is that God chooses to relinquish or give up some divine power in order to give human beings freedom, the freedom to make our own choices. Of course, having the ability to choose means we can make bad choices.
Ray, I don't think this is such a good idea.
Shut up, I know what I'm doing.
And bad choices often lead to bad things happening.
Uh-oh.
And sometimes the bad choices we make don't just affect us.
Larry, I don't think...
Shut up! I know what I'm doing!
Sometimes they hurt others around us.
Ew, gross!
I don't feel so good.
And more often than we realize, our bad choices can cause far-reaching damage. They can hurt people we've never even met, and who certainly didn't deserve it.
Hello, what's your name?
But why would God let us make bad choices?
Yeah, why doesn't God just take charge?
Okay, well, what would that look like? What would it be like if God made all of our choices for us? We sure love God.
Boy, do we love God.
You do? Oh, yes. May I ask why?
Because God told us to.
You see, the problem with that scenario is that we'd be unable to grasp what our relationship with God really is.
What is relationship?
Exactly. Without possessing your own mind, you can't really be in a relationship, not fully, or even know what one is. Because relationships require mutuality in order to be loving relationships. God wants nothing more than a deep, intimate relationship with us. But God also created us to have our own minds, our own thoughts, our own perspectives. Without these, we'd basically all just be a bunch of... zombies. When we stay open to a relationship with God, when we allow God to work in us and let God's love flow through us, some really great things can happen. But it's important to remember that even when you are in a relationship with God, you aren't immune from pain and suffering. And it isn't always because you or someone else made a bad choice. Sometimes bad things just happen to people, even to really nice people, innocent people, things that no one can control, like earthquakes or tornadoes. Or lightning. Or meteors. In the end, no one has a satisfactory answer about why God lets bad things happen. At the same time, God is constantly doing everything possible to transform decay, death, and destruction into abundant life, including dying on the cross, true, sacrificial, undeserved suffering for us. What truly matters most for us is how we respond to bad things that happen. If we let God work in us and let God's love flow out of us to others in need, in pain, even people who have hurt us, that's when you start to see God doing amazing things through us, helping to make this a better world.
I love the guy got his sandwich back. That's what I'm always looking for. I like the teaching very much that explains why God is not responsible for the suffering we experience in life. God knew that for us to have the best possible life, we needed to have free will. In other words, the freedom to make good or sometimes bad choices. if God didn't give some power over to us, what tradition has called God's omnipotence, meaning God's ability to control everything and everyone, it would have meant all of us being controlled, like puppets on God's strings. Although maybe that sounds kind of good, it really wouldn't be. God giving us free will allows us to be responsible for ourselves and do good. And unfortunately, sometimes we do bad towards ourselves or others. So getting back to my friend Thuy needing to leave Vietnam and all the people who fled war and poverty and suffering, God couldn't stop all of that from happening. Humans and our governments sometimes make very bad choices. They make rules that aren't always fair, discriminating against some while privileging others. What God could do and did do and does do was suffer along with the people God loves. God loves them so much. God loves us each so much and suffers with us when we go through really hard times. God wants the best for us so we can live full and good lives, all of us. And the good news for us today, Canada's Asian heritage has been made richer for the 100,000 Vietnamese people who came to Canada between 1975 and 1999. Some came by way of boats through other countries, and others fled in different ways. Many suffered to come here, leaving everything they had behind and everyone they knew to start life in a different but safe and good place. Be they Buddhist or Christian, they all had a hope. Thuy is grateful for all these years later to be a Canadian now. And it was worth it to go through the hardship and uncertainty to find her new life here. She's a very kind and smart and gentle person. I know you would all enjoy meeting her. Maybe one day we will get to meet her. We can always hope. Amen. So that's our moment with our young people this morning. We know that you're going to go off and speak more about these really amazing questions with Sherry and Sabs and whoever is here to go with you. So we wish you well, and we will see you later. Amen.
Good morning. As much as suffering and hardship have always been a part of human life, so has hope been a central feature of Christian life since Jesus first emerged as a transformational rabbi and teacher. The Apostle Paul picked up on this hope, as we will hear. Despite the persecutions he and other believers knew because of their faith, he believed that the good that would come out of enduring such hardship would be more than worth the effort. Could such hope be available to us, ready to transform us and our lives? Reading from Romans 8, verses 18, 24, 25, and 28. Let's listen. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory about to be revealed to us. For in hope we are saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. Friends, this is the witness of an early Christian community. May we find wisdom for our living.
Amen and amen for all the ways that we receive the word of God this morning. Amen. Would you pray with me, please? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be a witness, O God, to your way of love, justice, and faithful walking with us. Amen. As Christians, we dare to believe in the hope that God is present with us, no matter what, no matter who we are, no matter what we're going through, no matter the obstacles put in front of us, Dieu est avec nous. That God is present with us is the core of Jesus's message, of course. Even before the suffering he endured, being arrested and crucified like a common criminal, Jesus's reading of his scriptures revealed to him just how close and how loving was God, who he dared to call his own Abba Father, his Papa, his intimate, loving Father. God to Jesus, in other words, was like family. Opening God's arms to the beloved Son, opening God's heart in this new revelation, God with us, Dieu avec nous, Emmanuel. Through Jesus, we all get adopted into God's family too. All we need to do is believe and to hope. Yes, hope and faith are not the same as a fact and knowing something to be a fact. But hope in what we do not see, but on which we bet with our whole lives, that is powerful. Even as we consider how God gives up some of his or her power, did you hear that? Know this omnipotence thing. She gives up some of that power so that we can be more than just those puppets on God's even very loving and very beautiful strings. We become actors in our lives, for better and sometimes for worse. We get to choose to love or withhold love. As societies, we often get it wrong, don't we? Denying the humanity of others who look different or believe different things from us. But we also get to rise to the occasion too, don't we? Daring to hope, daring to act, in concert with the Holy One, we all can call Mother, Father, Creator, God. With our young people earlier, I mentioned the hope that we might get to meet my friend Thuy Tran one day. And you lucky people are going to get to meet her right now. I had the chance to speak with her on Friday with her special Canadian adopted family and friends of mine, Julianne LaBreche and Barry Wilson. We're going to meet them, I hope, right now. All right, here we are on a Sunday morning with Trinity and Anjou United Churches, and it's Asian Heritage Month, and we're talking about hope. I'm so pleased to have friends in Ottawa who are here today to help me have a conversation about hope and about
a wonderful group of people from Indochina and specifically from Vietnam who came to Canada under quite extraordinary and quite difficult circumstances. Many of you will remember that time. So I'd like to welcome Thuy Tran and Julianne Labrèche and Barry Wilson to our worship this morning. I met Thuy through Barry and Julianne when I was the minister at Low United Church prior to coming to Montreal. It was such a privilege to meet Thuy and her family as well. But thank you for being part of this conversation. So Thuy, you come from Vietnam. Could you just tell us just a little bit about your background and how it is that you became a refugee and came to Canada?
Yeah, thank you for having me here. Yeah, I left Vietnam when I was 16 as a refugee by boat people, as many people know, back in 1998 when I left Vietnam when I was 16. So I came to refuge in Malaysia, refugee camp by boat. So I lived there for 2.5 years. And Julianne and Barry sponsored me through the refugee list, came under a minority. That's here I am.
Wow. And how long a journey was it to come from your home to then come to Canada?
I don't come to Canada directly. I came by boat. So the journey, I'm lucky, one of lucky people. I travel on the sea by small boat. Take me about 3.5 days to arrive to Malaysia.
I see. And then you were there for some time.
Two and a half years.
Okay. And is that where Barry and Julianne come in?
So we had heard about the boat people coming to Ottawa. Marianne Dewar was the mayor of at the time, and she was welcoming about 4,000 boat people. And Barry and I have felt very blessed that we've had such a good life here in Canada, and it seemed like a small thing to offer someone some help for a while as they got settled in Canada. So we dealt with an immigration service here to sponsor someone. We didn't know who it was, but then we started these letter exchanges with Thuy, and we got to know her through her letters. She wrote very glowingly of the beautiful snowy winters that she would experience.
Uh-huh.
She came here, and then which means
we didn't get to know her at all through her letters.
Yeah, so anyway, she had very romantic thoughts, I think, about Canada, which didn't turn out to be quite the way she thought it was going to be. She ended up coming on a cold January day, and I think she was just totally overwhelmed. Who wouldn't be? I can't imagine how difficult it would have been for her.
Wow. How old were you, Thuy, when you came?
I came when I was 19.
19. And did you come on your own?
Yes, I came on my own.
Okay.
And one of the sponsor people called Julianne and Barry unexpectedly. So I arrived at their door.
Yeah, we weren't expecting to see Thuy. Barry, why don't you tell that story?
Well, we were going to sponsor her and pay for her way here. And then when the Canadian officials met her, they decided she'd be a great government-sponsored person. So basically, they told us we were out of the picture, we're out of the process. They were going to bring her in and send her money back, you know, basically.
So we were not expecting to see her. We just figured that Thuy would go somewhere in Canada, and we didn't ever expect we'd even get to meet her. And then one day she just arrived literally on our doorstep, because she didn't know anyone in Canada. And so when the government people asked her where she wanted to go, she said Ottawa, because we were the only people that she knew. So it just became very informal. We met one weekend in January and just said, well, why don't you spend the weekend, because you don't know anyone here. And you just had a little bit of clothing.
Two pairs of clothes, and that's it, and a jacket.
Wow. That's amazing.
Really nothing.
So we thought that that Thuy wasn't coming to Ottawa. We weren't privy to this negotiation they had about where she would end up. So she went to, she landed in Toronto. So I'm working one day in the Parliamentary Press Gallery on Parliament Hill. We had been dealing with this group in Ottawa, and the man's name, our contact there, was Mr. Vu. He was a, I believe, Vietnamese person. So I'm working one afternoon, and the phone rang. Good morning, Vu. It's Vu. Yes, I know Vu. I recognize your voice. She's here. Who's here? Who is here? Who is where? Here, Ottawa. What? Oh my God, I said, and he said, oh my God, because they were caught off guard. So I then called Julianne and said, guess who's coming to dinner?
Guess who's coming to dinner, yeah.
I'm expecting.
Not quite that, but so anyway, he said, and she's here, she's in Ottawa, you know? And so then we arranged for her to come and hear her stories of how much she loved snow.
I
didn't hear any of that after she saw it. So,
So anyway, things, just one thing led to another. And we just said, you know, Thuy, we were going to have you live with us for a few years anyway. So, you know, why don't you just stay with us for a while and see how it goes? And there was a lot of paperwork at first, because Thuy didn't know much English, and you know, she needed to get enrolled in school and deal with some of the logistics of healthcare and insurance and other things. So anyway, she just ended up staying and becoming part of our family.
Yay.
And so it worked out. And so now I just feel like, wow, we were the lucky ones. We were the ones who were really blessed, because Thuy and her family have just been so important to us.
Yes, I'm with me. I have lucky to stay with Julianne and Barry, the luckiest people as a refugee.
Wow. And Thuy, I know your life has blossomed here in Canada.
Yes.
So yeah, you're married with children and doing well.
Yes, I am very blessed.
Wow. Well, that's indicative of Thuy, the change that you sort of embraced by coming to this country and wanting to become part of this crazy place we call home.
Yes.
I'm going to say Thuy is very modest, but she's been extremely successful in Canada. She has a full-time job now in technology. Her husband, Peter, has a very good job. They have a lovely home. And she has raised two beautiful children who are in their 20s now. One's an engineer and one is a research scientist, and very, very bright and more important, very, very kind. So anyway, she's really a very remarkable person. I was saying at supper time tonight, before we started this interview, I just can't imagine going to another country at 16 or 17 and, you know, jumping into a culture where I don't even know yes from no, and can't understand and have very little in terms of money or support. What a challenge that must have been.
I can only imagine. And Thuy, just as maybe we're going to end our conversation, but I'm wondering about the points of hope that sort of drove you at various points during that journey. I'm sure there were moments where you were like, what am I doing and where am I going? But can you just name maybe where you got your hope from?
Yeah, when I left, I had no hope at all, because I never left home by myself. And when I live in a refugee camp, there's hoping for a better life. I'm lucky to come to Canada and meet Julianne and Barry. They give me a big hope about Canada. They teach me a lot and, up until now. So they are my second parents in Canada.
Oh,
big hope for everyone out there. There's always hope at the end of the tunnel.
Well, and we know that refugee crises continue to happen, unfortunately, in our world. And it's quite remarkable. I was doing a little bit of research before I got on the line with you, and I didn't realize that really Canada pioneered the private sponsorship of refugees, and it was around this time in the mid 70s, and even got an award, as like the people of Canada got a humanitarian award for that effort. So, and we I think continue to demonstrate a great deal of generosity towards refugee crises that happen, although we know it's never perfect. And but really, just Barry and Julianne, I just think your generosity of spirit, and by goodness, the government of Canada got you off the dime. That's really something. Although I think we pay in taxes, so.
Yeah. I think I paid over the years.
Well, I wish we could talk even more, but I know we should call this story to an end. But Tweed, thank you very much for coming to Canada and being part of who we are, part of the Vietnamese community, part of who we are as a multicultural society that is so enriched. And in fact, we need immigrants. Did I hear that? We're not having enough babies on our own. So places around the world have such hard times and political crises, economic, et cetera. And we're just so rich for the hope that people have to come here and to become part of who we all are. So thank you so much. And great to see you all. I really appreciate it.
Well, we'll have to come and have some Vietnamese food with us
someday.
Can I invite the whole congregation to come?
Best food ever.
I'm making some spring roll next time.
Amen.
I knew we would all be there for the spring rolls, absolutely. Isn't we wonderful? And well, so are Julianne and Barry too, in my book. Twi had no hope before she took that step to get on the boat, not knowing where this step would lead her. We know many others who escaped Vietnam in those years who didn't make it, and God, we believe, was with them in their suffering. As much as God stayed with those who, like Twi, were able to make it out, to years of living in a refugee camp, to writing letters to Canada she could barely imagine, and to people she would only meet when she arrived on their front door unexpected. People like Julianne and Barry, who opened their arms and hearts to this 19-year-old fleeing one life to find another. It would turn out to find another glorious life, becoming Canadian, contributing to so much of who we are as a people. So yes, there is much suffering in the world and suffering in our lives. And so much of it, unfortunately, is self-inflicted. So much stems from the power God gives us to be actors in our own stories, which we collectively get wrong, especially so wrong so often, causing war, oppression, cruelty, and more. And yet, God is there, present with us, we believe, working with us together for good for all those who love God, absolutely, but also for all those whom God loves. And that, my friends, is everyone. Amen. We sing these words, God of the Bible, verses 1, 2, and 5. I forgot to turn the page there. Yay, amen. You may be seated. In our life and work as a church, just several announcements to share. First of all, next Sunday will be the last Sunday if you'd like to contribute to the Garland and Best Families Walking in the Alzheimer's Walk. So please do see David or Gary, Dolores or Diane, if you would like to help them help people and research with Alzheimer's. Another virus-driven illness that we are learning more and more about these days is used to be called chronic fatigue syndrome. It's now ME, and I don't have it in front of me, myocardial, whatever the E stands for. Sorry, Andrea, you're listening. I need to know that. However, Anjou United Church is going to sponsor an afternoon tea for ME on Saturday, June 11th at 3:00 in the afternoon at Anjou. And we would love folks to come and share tea and little dainties with us. If you have teacups at home, examples of teacups that might be in your glass cabinet or whatever, bring a teacup or two either to use or just to, we'll have a display of all the beautiful teacups that I know many of us have. And do we use them that often? Maybe not these days. Come to our tea for ME on the 11th, Saturday afternoon at 3 at Anjou, and we'll get to enjoy all of that. And we'll have a donation basket too to raise money for a foundation that coordinates research for ME and CFS. Thank you for that. We'll say more as that comes closer. I'd like to thank Rosemary for the lilacs that are here, I think from her own bushes this morning. They are beautiful. And I think I can smell them too. Just the lilac smell is lovely. Wanted to let folks know we are in Anjou next Sunday, the last Sunday of the month. I'm going to be away this week visiting family in the States, so I hope you'll come, and Jean-Philippe will be with all of you, and he's looking forward to seeing everyone online as well as in person. Gary has an announcement, and I think Michaela as well.
I'm here to talk to you about Broadview Magazine. Used to be called the United Church Observer. It has the honor of being the oldest continuously published magazine in North America, having existed since 1829. I personally have subscribed to it since, about 45 years ago, and I read this cover to cover every month. I highly recommend it. It's a wonderful magazine. It's associated with the United Church of Canada, but independent. And anybody can get a subscription for, I think, $29.95 a year. But since we do form a group here at Trinity, we can get subscriptions for $25. And Judy Chichola is collecting the money for that, so I highly recommend it. If you'd like to subscribe to Broadview Magazine, please see Judy. And there's more information how to contact her in the weekly email. Broadview Magazine, highly recommended. Michaela?
Good morning, everyone. I just wanted to take a moment to highlight the media ministry for those in sanctuary. I'm behind you, so you won't see me on screen. So our ministry, as most people are aware, we handle like putting together and producing our service, our audio, our visual, everything like that. We have a very small team, and we just want to let people know that if you are interested in joining the media ministry, please come talk to me. You don't have to have any special skills necessarily. Maybe even for young people, perhaps they have zero interest in producing and visuals and computers, but maybe you know someone that thinks, well, maybe I'd like to be a DJ when I grow up. So maybe they could learn a little bit about the how to control the audio mixer. Maybe you have a young person who loves to play video games, or everyone in here is young at heart. If you love to play video games, even our camera controller, like we have various pieces of equipment that we use in producing our service. And even if someone is only interested in perhaps like, okay, you're going to be the camera control person. The joystick and that control is all yours. And so we are looking for people that want to join the team. And yeah, just come see me. We'll sit down, we'll talk about things. We'll see what your skills are, what you identify as your strengths and weaknesses, and we'll work from there and try to place you within our team, you know, building on those strengths and getting you contributing to the church, to this family. And, you know, it would be very much welcome and appreciated. So come see me whenever. Thank you.
Thank you, Michaela. And just a note, we were not at all sure how the audio was going to go today. You know, it's cut out at various times. I think we get an A plus, Michaela. Oh my gosh, God is helping us this morning. Amen. A lot of videos to share, and there's one more to go. Maybe I jinxed it. No, God, please.
I will put out a disclaimer that our audio issue is not yet resolved. We've just taken some approaches today, and we have luckily done well thus far.
Wonderful. Last announcement is elected leaders. We were giving out geraniums last week as part of our thank you to outgoing and incoming elected leaders at Trinity in Anjou. If you haven't picked up the flower yet, there's some in my office. There's one beautiful one right here. So please don't go away without one. All that we are, all that we hope to be, is part of being God's people together. Let us bring our gifts of ourselves, our time, our talent, our volunteering, our ideas and visioning, and our treasure for God's good purposes. Anybody know how to whistle? I wish I could. Let us be in prayer. Oh God, we live in a beautiful, diverse world, and we thank you for all the cultures that make us who we are. We thank you for the gifts each person that comes to our neck of the woods, who comes into our doors here at Trinity and at Anjou United Churches, Montreal and Canada, each one so precious. May our gifts help those who are especially in need, and by sharing the vision of your love, your presence that is surely with us. Amen. As our prayers continue with our prayers of the people, I'll be sharing a poem that was written by a Korean-American Presbyterian pastor named Irina Kim Eubanks. It's called Fearfully, Wonderfully. Let us be in prayer. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful, I know that full well. And yet the gifts of being Asian and American or Canadian in these lands, we have rarely known. Buried beneath the weight of yellow peril, the model minority, or exotic and oriental. Hidden behind the labels of other, foreigner, stranger, we have felt fear more than wonder, exclusion more than embrace. But to acknowledge your works is in us is to acknowledge that you are a good creator. To celebrate the gifts we carry is to remember you are a generous giver. So today we choose praise. We praise you for ancestors who carried tears in their eyes, hopes in their hearts, and memories in their bags, names, their stories, and faces they carried in their minds. We praise you for these sojourners leaving behind revolutions and genocides, families lost in mushroom clouds, lands destroyed from colonization, homes ravaged by wars they did not start, names too demanding for the white man's tongue. We praise you for the work of their hands, diplomas that weren't valued here, songs and poems lost to thick accents, sweat unseen and poured out on railroads and farms, laundromats and factories, lives given up for family and country. I praise you for our resistance leaders marching for just immigration laws, fair labor practices, freedom from internment, protection from hate and violence, dreaming of civil rights for all. I praise you for the unseen expressions of love, bellies filled up, fruit cut after meals, bills paid in secret, for intuition and indirect communication, for never having to be asked. I praise you for theologies of Han and Jiang, for scripture read with the eyes of the exiled, for God as creator, as mother, as master, for Jesus, the one from a liminal place, for deep understandings of honor and shame. I praise you for communion performed with roti, hymns uttered in mother tongues, after church fellowship over juk and sinigang, early morning prayer before the crack of dawn. I praise you for churches that were language schools, welcome centers, culture preservers, for dining tables transformed into remnants of home. For every gift, both seen and unseen, valued and dismissed, named and silenced, we praise you. We are fearfully, wonderfully made. And O God, we ask that you hear now the prayers of our hearts. Listen to us, won't you now? God, special prayers again for Deborah Dolly Udit and her family as they will say goodbye to Kevin in death on tomorrow afternoon. May our spirits be with them to provide comfort, we pray. We think of people in Ukraine still suffering under bombardment and war. We think of people around the world depending on the grain of Ukraine and Russia too, to get to markets so that the world will not go hungry. Be with each name on our prayer list, all the situations there that we pray over during the week. We hear of the names and the people that were gunned down in the top supermarket in Buffalo simply because they were targeted in a black neighborhood. Oh God, we lament that such evil can happen, and yet we know you are with those of us who suffer. Thank you for your presence here with us today and ever. For hearing our prayers, for answering in your way and time, we give you thanks this day and always. Amen. Our final hymn is Hope of the World. You'll find the words on screen or on page 5 of your bulletin. Christ above me, Christ behind me, Christ before me, Christ all around me, all around us. Let us go into this week ahead, bringing Christ's peace, Christ's hope, and Christ's love to everyone we might meet. Amen. Good day, everyone, and good morning to everyone on Zoom, or good afternoon. So nice to see everyone here in our virtual community. Hello, hello, hello.